In September 2013, employees at Fazio Mechanical and HVAC Company were hard at work. This was a pretty cool company specializing in commercial refrigeration. They had a contract with Target, which means they had access to various Target web applications for electronic billing, contract submission, and project management purposes. It started like any other hack. Facebook and Google fell for it, paying millions to fake invoices. The local power grid company fell for it, making hundreds of thousands lose power. Even Linus Tech Tips fell for it, allowing for a special collaboration with Elon Musk to give away free crypto. And with a single phishing email, the ball began rolling. A Fazio employee downloaded and ran the perfectly innocuous PDF attachment, releasing the Citadel Trojan into its native habitat. This universal spyware system was unique in that it was massively distributed. There were frequent updates, live support, and a trouble ticket system where users can make feature requests and monitor development progress. If your Trojan was not behaving as expected, you could always page the Citadel Trojan on-call engineer. Okay, maybe not that one. Citadel specializes in stealing credentials and has many tools to do so. Methods such as keylogging, screenshotting, or even video capturing websites of interest, as well as man-in-the-browser attacks are used. This involves injecting code into the victim's browser, which can read and modify traffic being sent from client to server and vice versa. Citadel's secret ability, however, is to inject fake input forms on real websites which users unknowingly enter their personal information into. Now the next step was to do all of this without getting caught. What sophisticated means would the hackers employ to thwart Fazio's industry-compliant security measures? Well, these security measures turned out to just be the free version of Malwarebytes, which lacked the real-time monitoring that could have caught them. So through any of the aforementioned tactics, Fazio's credentials had now fallen unnoticed into enemy hands. The hackers can now log into Target's contractor-only websites, such as Ariba, Partners Online, and some property development thing, but just being able to use these web applications meant nothing. The hackers could only interface with features which Target chose to put into the website, which likely didn't include root shell access to any of their servers. However, an exploit on one of these websites did allow for some level of remote code execution, the most devastating of security vulnerabilities. This allowed the hackers to run code on the application server itself, installing a backdoor and giving the hackers direct access to the server. Okay, but how was this done? If you recall from the Heartland breach a few years prior, this step was accomplished through SQL injection and a SQL server procedure which spawns a Windows command shell and passes in a string for execution. A similar method could have been used here, but the exact details were never revealed. There are also other theories. For example, within the list of publicly disclosed hacker tools, there was a strange PHP file which stood out among all the executables. The theory is founded on the fact that one of these websites must have supported uploading documents, which is quite likely, say for contracts and invoices. Then the hackers took advantage of this to upload their malicious PHP script. After uploading the file, it could have been then executed through a local file inclusion vulnerability. Assuming the web app was also built with PHP, PHP has a feature where you can include a PHP file within another PHP file, which simply executes the code in the included file. This included file can even be specified by user input. For example, this sample website allows users to select a language which sends a request to the server with a specified language. Then the server-side code includes the PHP file of the requested language which executes its contents. If improperly validated, the user can pass in any file path to be included and executed, which in this case could have been the suspicious PHP file uploaded through existing website functionality. Whatever the case, the initial step of getting into Target's network was the hardest part, as it took the hackers around 2 months to figure all of this out. So by mid-November, the attackers had infiltrated the network and controlled this particular web server. Their end goal, however, was to reach the point of sale systems to steal all the credit cards. The architecture here was the typical Microsoft setup. Identity management was through Microsoft Active Directory, which tracks objects within a company's network, such as users' computers and printers, as well as their permissions, and organizes them into a hierarchical structure. Each user is granted a certain level of privilege to access the network resources they need, with some more privileged than others. So now privilege escalation was the name of the game, and the hackers eventually had access to highly permissive users such as the domain administrator. How did they do this? First, many applications and systems had weak or default administrator passwords. Some servers even contained files with valid network credentials. Second, many of these systems were missing critical security patches. As a result, there were many known exploits in these applications that could be used to dump credentials. Furthermore, the protocol used by Active Directory at the time to authenticate users had various weaknesses. But most surprisingly, there was very little to no network segmentation or firewalling between Target's corporate and payment devices. The point-of-sale devices and cash registers within Target's stores were easily reachable from the corporate network. Once inside Target's network, there was nothing to stop attackers from gaining direct and complete access to every single cash register in every Target store. There were no controls limiting their access to any system, including devices within stores such as point-of-sale registers and servers. And Verizon security consultants hired post breach were able to communicate directly with cash registers in checkout lanes after compromising a deli meat scale located in a different store. Either way, this leg of the breach was comparatively easy, as Verizon was also able to crack 86% of Target's passwords for these major domains in less than a week. And the hackers probably had a similar experience, as it only took them 3 days from initial entry to reach the point of sale systems. So scanning for IPs accessible from their starting web server, they eventually made their way across the entire network. Okay, so the hackers had access to the point-of-sale devices, but how were they stealing the credit cards? Within these devices, scanned card data needs to pass through memory before being passed to the payment processing provider. With the correct software, the memory can be scraped for credit card data. The software in question here was Black POS, which was designed to steal credit cards on Windows-based point-of-sale machines. For around $2,000, this absolutely unsophisticated and uninteresting, but also incredibly sophisticated tool can be purchased on your local cybercrime forum. But what does it do? On infected hosts, the malware automatically starts up with an inconspicuous name, looks for processes which interact with the card reader, and performs a typical RAM scraping attack. 10 megabyte chunks of memory are dumped from these processes and parsed for track 1 and track 2 financial card data. This was traditionally done with regex, but allegedly this target variant had a different super-fast secret sauce logic. Any credit card information that is found is encrypted and saved in a DLL file for obfuscation purposes. A second background thread would then periodically forward the file to a compromised internal server in the corporate network. Lastly, there was a separate data exfiltration malware installed on this server to transfer the stolen data to a Russian FTP server. As a side quest, the hackers also stole a bunch of customer data from the various databases they had access to. So for the 2 weeks from late November to mid-December, the scheme ran without issues and stole in total 70 million records of non-financial customer data and 40 million credit and debit cards. By encrypting the data and performing this multi-phase data exfiltration, as well as getting really lucky, the hackers were able to circumvent Target's security systems. You see, the hackers actually hadn't circumvented the security system at all. Target's malware intrusion system, FireEye, had detected the exfiltration malware multiple times, as the hackers were performing some rapid iteration on this software and kept updating it. However, the alert was simply too generic, so the staff thought they were false positives and ignored them. If Target took a closer look at these alerts or had malware auto removal turned on, the hackers could have been stopped at this last crucial step. It wasn't until the Department of Justice notified Target on December 12th of suspicious activity involving payment cards used at Target stores that they began an internal investigation. At this point, various third parties stepped in and had the attack under control by the 15th. This was a big hit to Target's finances, with net profit dropping 46% in Q4, as well as the obvious loss in customer trust. The CEO also stepped down shortly after, in part due to this data breach as well as the disastrous expansion into Canada. He received a modest $61 million severance package for his services. Taking these lessons to heart, by February the next year, Target commissioned another pen test and was found to be fairly robust at detecting and blocking cyber attacks. They had invested hundreds of millions into additional security personnel and building out a cyber fusion center to better respond to daily threats. Anyways, the main issue here was bad network segmentation. In Zero Trust security, we learn to trust nobody by default and to maintain the strictest access controls. It's not merely enough to protect from outsider attacks, it should be assumed that it is possible for an attacker to access the internal network, and the architecture here should be designed in a way to minimize damage. Nowadays, card scanning attacks like this are much rarer, as it only works against magnetic stripe cards. Most point-of-sale systems accept and favor EMV, which generates a unique transaction code for each payment. In the end, the hackers are still yet to be caught. There are some related arrests, however, as some developers and distributors of the Citadel malware have been arrested and sentenced over the years. But you can rest easy, as the class action lawsuit reached an $18.5 million settlement, which is a solid 46 cents per stolen credit card.